So now we're going to look at a downward impending motion of a screw that's not self-locking. So basically, we've got this screw that's wanting to slide down on its own because it's a loose screw, I guess. It just doesn't want to do it. So we're going to have a frictional force that's going to be preventing that motion from coming up. And we're also going to have a normal force that's going to be obviously preventing us from going through the ground. That would be silly. And I'm going to use my triangle law, or parallelogram law, or whatever law you want to call it, to go something like this, and then I can draw in my resultant. And I'm going to draw my resultant like this, because I think it's going to make it a little bit easier for me to mess with. Okay. Now, I'm going to go ahead and label my phi s, because this is my distance between my normal and such, but I'm going to kind of ignore that for a second, because what I want to do is I want to play with these similar triangles here, which is going to be harder to do. If I get too many more lines in here, it's going to start to get weird. So let's see what I want to do. Well, I know that I'm going to want to get an actual force in my XY directions. So let's see what I need to do now. If I want to look at just this triangle, doesn't really matter where I cut it, but if I pretend I've got myself a little triangle here, I can look at it a little bit better if I go ahead and, let me see if I can move this without causing too much disaster. I'm not sure I can. Looks like I did. There we go. No, well, I don't know why some things arbitrarily have decided to move, but that's still there. By moving that guy out just for a minute, I can really concentrate on what's going on here. Now, if I pretend I've got myself a right angle here, I can say, alrighty then. Well, since that was a phi, I mean, that was theta right there, I can say, well, since this here is also a right angle, then I can say that this one is 90 minus theta. And I guess it just depends on how you want to. I'm going to see if I can find a prettier way to do it than just that. I'm not feeling that pretty right now. So I think I'm just going to go ahead and stick with the idea that now I've got two parallel lines, so if I have a line running, not like that one, if I have a line intersecting two parallel lines, and this one over here is going to be 90 minus theta, and then I've got a right triangle, so that means that this one here is theta. And I'm sure there's a more clever way to do this, but it's just not coming to me right now. So we're going to stick with that one. So first of all, make sure you can recognize how we determine that that angle there is going to be theta. And so we'll use that. And I'm going to delete all these extra lines because I'm not going to need them anymore. I don't need this one or this one or this one or this one. All I need to know for sure is the one that I did. So now I can bring in my little resultant. Okay. So now by bringing in my resultant, I can say, well, this is going to be resolving my resultant, that's wonderful, into x and y planes. Now I can get rid of the frictional and normal forces altogether, because I'm not going to be using them anymore. I don't know if I can get rid of them without causing extreme damage, but that's most of it. Yeah, I can. I don't want to do that yet. Thank you. Let's not. Because I still need to know what this is. I know what that is, but I can't find this one right here specifically. I have to call that this one here is theta minus phi s. And that's how we get the theta minus phi s there. Okay. Now I can get rid of these guys, because they're not actually that helpful. There we go. Okay. Well, they were helpful for a long time, but now I don't need them anymore. In fact, I don't even need him anymore. But I can say that my x-coordinate is our sine, theta minus Vs. And my adjacent one is our cosine, theta minus Vs, just like that. And that's the hard part. As with the other examples, I'm going to have some weight force pushing down here. To prevent it, since it's not self-locking, I'm going to have to apply a force over here, M over R. And I don't know why it keeps shifting. It's kind of weird. A whole lot of stuff shifted, didn't it? Something's weird about this one. I'm going to pull this. Write that back in there. There we go. This is just being a toot today, isn't it? You say, hooray for things arbitrarily moving on the page. Alright. So now if we sum in the x direction, we get that m over r is going to be the same thing as, and I'll move it over in a sec, r sine theta minus Vs, like that. And if we sum in the y direction, we're going to get that w is r cosine theta minus Vs, and I can just divide those things by each other. So m over r, come on now. I'm going to try moving down here and see if that helps. M over R all over W is equal to tangent theta minus Vs. So that means I've got M over WR equals tangent minus V minus theta minus Vs. So I finally got that M equals WR tan theta minus Vs. And so that's how we can come up with a derivation for that one.